Hello, welcome to The Game Plan, where we bring you in-depth analysis of the greatest game of all you won't find anywhere else. I'm Zach Bailey, joined by Anthony Seibold. Seibs, we looked and talked about Eyes Up Footy earlier this year. Another term we always hear in rugby league circles is one percenters. What does that actually mean?
Yeah, well, they're the effort areas of our game. They're the areas of our game that don't require talent, they don't require skill, but they're ultra important because they require a choice. And so coaches and players make each other accountable to those choices in the game.
All right, so those one percenters, those effort areas are our focus here on The Game Plan today, in particular these key topics: kick chase, line speed, kick pressure, inside pressure, filling space off the ball, and push support. We've looked at these in some depth earlier in the year, but let's focus on the first one, kick chase. We saw a great example on Thursday night.
So this is the Raiders versus South Sydney game last Thursday night, and most coaches will talk to their team about the transition from attack to defence. So kick chase is one of those examples, and coaches will coach their team to have a minimum of 10 men in the line. And if we don't see that, that's when you do challenge your players. And as I said, this is from last Thursday night. You'll see the green machine marching down the middle third of the field here. And as I count the numbers, there's actually 11 Raiders players in the kick chase line. So Ricky Stewart would like that kick chase. Cody Walker, very dangerous player at the back. They needed to present a full line without any dints or without any triangles in the kick chase line. And they did a good job on Cody Walker last Thursday night, but that's what Ricky Stewart would like to see.
Another phrase they always say, or we always hear in rugby league circles, is your kick is only as good as its chase, and that was a classic example of it right there.
Yeah, definitely. And as I said before, Ricky Stewart would be looking to make sure that no one's being lazy and hanging back from that main kick chase line. That's when you'll see dints in the line. And fantastic players like Cody Walker or Latrell Mitchell, James Tedesco, etc., they take advantage of seeing any dints in the kick chase line.
So how can a defensive unit put pressure on that team trying to transition from attack to defence?
Well, this is another good example from the weekend. It was from Saturday night's game, Parramatta versus the Bulldogs game. And we're looking at Reid Marnie. Reid Marnie is someone that I consider watching him play to be great with the effort areas of the game. And this is him here in the defensive line. So Bulldogs this time are transitioning from attack to defence. So they want a good kick chase, or a good kick to start with from Flanagan into a 10-man minimum kick chase line. But Reid Marnie's trying to disrupt that kick. And what he does, he comes out and puts inside kick pressure, on Kyle Flanagan last Saturday night, comes up with the big play because Parramatta get the football. But this is what I want to point out to our viewers. It's the change of intensity that Brad Arthur would be looking at. You'll see Reid Marnie again. It's that 2 to 3 metre change of intensity just there. That's what Brad Arthur would be pointing out in the video review. And what he would be doing is highlighting that effort there from Reid Marnie. It didn't require talent. It didn't require skill. It required a choice.
So change of intensity, you used that phrase a couple of times there. How important is that in all of these effort areas?
Well, I feel as though it's the best indicator or best measurement of intensity in games. I don't necessarily look at the total distance run by players or even metres per minute. What I like to look at is accelerations density per minute. So how many times Reid Marnie or how many times the Parramatta players change their intensity within a set of six on both sides of the footy. That's what I like to look at.
So Brad Arthur would have loved that change of intensity from Reid Marnie. Craig Bellamy would have loved this change of intensity from a couple of his stars.
Yeah, Craig Bellamy certainly would have pointed this out in the video review this week. It's from last Friday night, the Cronulla versus Melbourne Storm game. Traditionally a really strong, challenging game. But some things stood out to me. This is tackle five. And the two players I want to point out are Brandon Smith, an A defender, and Justin Ollam, who's actually defending as a three, and he normally defends as a centre. But in this situation, Munster's outside him. Have a look at the change of intensity to start with from Brandon Smith. There it is. And what he does, he makes Chad Townsend, who's this attacking player here, pass the ball early. Now, because it's last, they've got an option. Sean Johnson can kick or he can run. Justin Ollam's job is to put inside pressure or kick pressure on Sean Johnson, and watch his change of intensity. There he goes. Makes the play, and it's a big play. But if I go back to the start of this particular clip, the two things that I want to point out are the 2 to 3 metre change of intensity from Brandon Smith and from Justin Ollam. There's Smith, there's Ollam, comes up with a big play because Kenny Bromwich picks the footy up, passes to Josh Adokar, who then goes and runs the distance. So it's a big play, but it was full of effort. It didn't take any talent or skill from Brandon Smith or Justin Ollam on that big particular play.
The ultimate reward there for the Storm. I would hate to have the block of cheese charging at me and the granite. That is Justin Ollam. The Roosters, another great example of that inside pressure and the impact it has on the outside players.
Yeah, certainly. So this time it's Ben Marski's turn to go for the Roosters. And you'll see him come into the picture just here. You'll see him come out of the line and put inside pressure on Chad Townsend in this situation. Now, it was his turn to go. He was on the inside of the attacking player. By him going out and putting inside pressure on Chad Townsend means that two players don't get caught up. These two guys here in Butcher, but also Jared Hargraves, are able to push through the line here, which means Matt Morland plays a little bit earlier than what he wants to. And the point I'm going to make here is, off the back of that, there's Will Kennedy with the footy, but there's one, two, three Roosters defenders versus one, two, three Sharks attacking players, and it's man on man. So it's an easy defensive situation for the left-hand side edge of the Roosters to handle, but all because of this change of intensity or this inside pressure from Ben Marski here.
And when this,
there it is.
When this play started, the Sharks actually had an overlap. So that is the result of that good inside pressure.
Yeah, by making the ball player play early, it means the edge can stay connected. They don't need to make any decision whatsoever, but it also means that we can actually get man on man at the end or on the end of the line. So a really good example there from Ben Marski. It was his turn to go. Trent Robinson, again, would be highlighting, or Craig Fitzgibbon, the defence coach, would be highlighting those effort areas that you see from Ben Marski, as Craig Bellamy and the staff at the Storm would do as well.
On the graphic we showed off the top, there was a line there that said filling a space. Another phrase that we hear sometimes in rugby league, but what does it actually mean?
Yeah, so some people call this shut the gate, some people call it fill the space. Essentially what I want to point out is this, the big human that is Nelson Asofa-Solomona, he's at marker here. Now this is play five, and it's the 74th minute of the game from a few weeks ago against the Roosters. So this is an example of fill the space. What I want you to do is watch Nelson Asofa-Solomona. He keeps moving just in case. It doesn't take talent, doesn't take skill, but he turns up there on the play as young Sam Walker gets the ball. Now, Roosters were chasing points at the end of the game in this particular situation, but at any given time, Nelson Asofa-Solomona could make the choice to stop moving, just in case. You know, he keeps moving just in case, like I said. It's a really big play at home or at the ground. You often don't see that. But Craig Bellamy, Steve Kearney, and the coaching staff of the Melbourne Storm would have been pointing that out and showing that that takes effort. It doesn't take skill, doesn't take talent, but it's a big play.
So you've been up in the coach's box before. Would you notice that on the run? You just said fans, myself sitting at home on the couch on a Friday or Saturday night, I wouldn't notice that effort area. But would you notice that on the run in the box?
Yeah, one of the reasons I like being up elevated position is so you can see those effort areas. And in a coach's box, you have a football analyst beside you who has a computer and has the ability to cut clips on the run. So that might be something you want to keep for after the game. Sometimes it's something you want to show at halftime. But generally speaking, you might say, who kept moving there? You'll get him to scroll back. Big Nelson Asofa-Solomona. You'll send a message down. Nelson, great job. Keep moving there with those effort areas in the game.
So Craig Bellamy, very happy there with Big Nelson. Trent Robinson would have loved what he's seen from Sam Walker with the ball in hand so far in his early NRL career. But you noticed an effort against the Dragons off the ball that really impressed you.
Yeah, very impressive by Sam Walker. He, as you said, he's got a lot of plaudits for what he's done on the football. But I'll point him out. He's at the very top of our screen. And there's a kick in behind. So Dragons are transitioning from attack to defence. And Daniel Tupu gets the ball about 20 metres in distance away from young Sam Walker. There's Tupu getting the ball all the way down there. Now, keep an eye on Sam Walker. As the play unfolds, Manu there filling in at fullback for Tedesco. There's Sam Walker getting behind the ball. So that's him out here now. He's obviously with Brett Morris. So they're both behind the football and they're options for Joseph Mana to use. So instead of getting tackled and there into the field, they make another 30 or 40 metres and they actually make more metres than where the Dragons keep the ball from. So if Sam Walker didn't move off the footy, if he didn't make the choice to get behind the footy, then Roosters would be coming out of their end. But by making the choice and moving and doing his work early, then they get the advantage. And then they're on the front foot, which means they can attack the line. At the very least, they're handing over the ball with Dragons coming off their own line, all because of that one play.
What does that say about Sam Walker and his game awareness at such a young age?
Well, I think it says a lot about the whole Roosters team. Watching them play live on Saturday night, one of the things I was super impressed with were the effort errors in their game on both sides of the footy. So defensively, they were great with their kick pressure, their inside pressure and filling the space. And then on the ball, their genuine push support was outstanding. But what it says about Sam Walker is he understands the importance of choosing to do those effort errors.
All right, you just mentioned there you are watching firsthand as a Knights consultant. This wouldn't have pleased you too much, or I guess you wouldn't have been too happy with seeing this push support from the Roosters.
Yeah, it's fantastic by the Roosters. It really is. And the player we want to highlight is Satili Tupanua out here. Him and Angus Crichton are exceptional at being genuine when they push support. So what I mean by that is they run for real. So they are a genuine option to get the footy. And in this case here, you'll see Joseph Manu running across field, but because of Satili Tupanua, and I'll take it back a little bit, I want you to watch the change of intensity from Satili here. There it is there, which means he gets a one-on-one with Bradman Best. Now, again, the Roosters push support on Saturday night was outstanding. You'll see Sam Walker come into the picture. You'll see Manu come into the picture. You'll also see Brett Morris come into the picture. But that work there off the footy by Satili Tupanua meant that the Roosters poke a hole in the Knights' defence. But again, that's not a skill or a talent by Satili Tupanua. It's a choice to make that effort and push in support with Joseph Manu.
And again, it's not only him, but it's Sam Walker and having the trust in your player on the inside. They almost always know that someone is going to be there up the middle.
The thing I like about the Roosters game at the moment is they've got a lot of missing personnel, but there's a real mentality to do something for your teammate there. So, like I said, a lot of these choices means that they're putting the team first, and I like how they're playing their football at the moment.
All right, the Rabbitohs, they love going to their left edge, but they went to their right edge against the Raiders. And another example of that change of pace, change of intensity and that push support.
Yeah, so the two players we want to point out is young Keon playing in the back row there on the right-hand side for the Rabbitohs, but also Jaden Sua, who's been exceptional this season through the first eight rounds. But again, great attacking shape, good attacking awareness there by Adam Reynolds. Keon runs an overs line against some jammed defence and he goes through. So it's a really good push support to start with. But if I back it up a little bit, I just want people to watch Jaden Sua. Jaden Sua will be on the right-hand side of Keon. Fantastic pass, fantastic ability there by Keon to pass in traffic. But again, if I take that back, it's all about the choice that Jaden Sua makes. You'll see his change of intensity as the play unfolds. There it is. Pushes up on the right-hand side shoulder of Keon and fantastic finish, but it's a choice.
But if he doesn't make that choice, Tom Starling and one of the Raiders players...
The play gets shut down. Yeah, essentially the play gets shut down. But that change of intensity there by Jaden Sua was an outstanding example of what it looks like in attack. That's an effort error. It's a choice. It's a one percenter. Whatever language you want to use, but all the different examples I've showed here today are all about changes of intensity. It's about making the choice to change your intensity for 2 to 3 metres. And you even saw with young Sam Walker off the football, he decided to change his intensity and get back behind the outside backs of the Roosters there. And because he did things like that, the Roosters march another 30 or 40 metres downfield.
All right, so all those effort areas and those one percenters, they please the coach. But in the big picture, how important are they?
Well, I think they're the difference between the best teams in the competition and the teams towards the back end. Every team's got talent. Every team's got skill in the competition. Every team trains very similar. I think what differentiates the best teams versus the teams down towards the bottom are making the choice in and around those effort areas, because you're not just making a choice for yourself. It's what you do off the football. We only actually have our hands on the football for a very limited amount of time within each game. So it's about what you do off the ball. And I think the effort areas in our game certainly for me distinguish the best versus the rest.
All right, so you can notice that on the run, whether you're in the coach's box or sitting at home. But what about myself as a fan? How would you encourage me to keep an eye out for those effort areas? Would you say after a try, sit there, you know, without the commentary on and you pause it on the run? Or how do you become more...
Yeah, so I think about if you watch your team that your support gets scored against, have a look at the shape and have a look if there's any inside pressure from defenders. So have a look at the marker. Is there any change of intensity? Have a look at the A or B defender. Is there any change of intensity from the inside? On last plays, when teams are transitioning from attack into defence, again, have a look at the markers or the A defenders in particular. Are they changing their intensity to go and put kick pressure on, similar to the example that we did with that we showed with Reid Marnie there. They're the types of things that you look at. So again, it actually becomes quite interesting to watch it as a supporter when you see those changes of intensity. And the same with the attack. Have a look at Roosters' push support. Have a look at South Sydney's push support. Have a look at Melbourne Storm's push support. And then compare it against the team that you support. You know, are they genuine options? Are they running for real? And if they've got themselves in the picture there, can the ball player tip onto them? Because a lot of times, like you see with the Satili Tupanuri example, having that push support gets a one-on-one. At the very least, even if Bradman Best made that tackle, at the very least, it's quick by the ball. And Roosters have all the momentum. Because the Roosters are so good with their push support, they had other players in the frame there. But, yeah, I'd encourage fans to have a look at it.
And you said there the difference between the best and the not, or the best and the rest, yep, in terms of the NRL are those effort areas. What about if you're a player on the fringe of an Origin selection and Freddie and Paul Green are sitting back and picking their teams? Will that have an influence on their selection?
Yeah, having experienced Origin as an assistant coach with Queensland there for a couple of years, I do know that the selectors and the head coaches and the coaching staff of those teams, they look at the effort areas of the game. Because, as I said, everyone who plays NRL is talented. They don't make the NRL if they don't have some type of talent or some type of skill. What differentiates the NRL players to the Origin players are those effort areas, and it's all off the ball, and often it's down to those changes of intensity on both sides of the football. So you can see why in a big game like the State of Origin games are each and every single year, you've got to have trust in your players that they'll make the choice to go and change their intensity, to get in the kick chase line, to put kick pressure on when it's their turn, to put inside pressure on when it's their turn. Essentially, that's what the Origin coaches are looking at.
Yeah, and there were none better than the great Jonathan Thurston back in the day. He called the Blues on so many occasions. Yeah. Steve, as always, thanks for that great insight. Thank you for joining us on The Game Plan once again. I hope you got plenty out of today's segment.